Hey, hello everyone, and I'm hoping you all are doing well. When I'm talking of doing well, I'm also meaning that you all are spending your time productively. I tell you one small thing, when after or maybe after the lockdown, after the exams are done, or after a few months or after maybe a year, when we look back at 2020, the months of February, March, April, May even, we'll be having two options. Either look back at these months with regret, or look back at these months with happiness. There may be regret if we do not use this time productively. So I am urging everyone, please use this time productively. Yeah, invest at least 3 to 4 to 5 hours in trying to hone your skills, or in trying to improve your skills, in trying to learn a new skill. I'm also hoping that every one of you is doing well, and everyone in your family is also doing well. Please stay happy, stay positive, and stay productive in this time, or in these times. Moving on, sorry, I forgot to wish you all a very good morning, a very good afternoon also maybe, or a very good evening. Because I do not know when you all will be watching this video. And if I say good morning, it will be like, I am watching this video at night, why is it telling good morning? Or I am watching this video in the evening, then why should sir be telling me good morning now, or what do you think? So, that is why, so as to cater to everyone, I am serving you all this wishes, good morning, good evening, good afternoon in a buffet. Leaving aside all that, coming to, when we are talking of reformation, or when we are dealing with Renaissance. When we are dealing with Renaissance, I was telling that Renaissance came in because people started asking questions, people started thinking, people started wanting freedom to think. And I tell you all, or suppose if today someone tells you, you cannot think, or you do not have the capability, ability, or the permission to think, what will be your reaction? I guess you all won't be liking that. That was the condition of the people of England, or sorry, most of Europe. And after some time, when they got the ability to think, that ability to think also asked them to, or when they started thinking, they also started asking a few questions. A few questions to whom? The church. Because it was the church who was at the forefront of everything. The church was there so as to control all the aspects of life of the people of Europe and Spain. When I'm talking of the church was controlling all the life of the people of Europe in every way, whatever they paint, whatever they do, whatever they eat, whatever they think also. So that was it. And after people were given the opportunity and the freedom to think, people started asking the church first, what are you doing? People understood that the church was becoming corrupt every day. It was not the church, actually the church officials, who we refer to as the clergy. So these people, the clergymen, they were becoming corrupt. They were amassing huge amounts of property in the name of religion. And as this started happening, people started getting angry that we are the ones who were being asked to lead moral lives. You all are the ones who are doing these things. So people started attacking the church, not attacking as in go and hit them, attacking them verbally, I mean attacking them by words. And people started asking the church why. The church had no answer. So people, because the church was having huge amounts of properties, the church had invested in land, church had invested in banks, church had huge money. So people were a bit angry with the church. That led the people to move a bit away from the church. People started understanding, or there were a few people, you may call them as leaders. So there were a few leaders who started urging the people, please do not listen to what the church says. Listen to what the Bible says. Because as we know that Christianity, or the main fundamentals of Christianity, lies in the Bible. So people, or the leaders of these movements, they started urging people, asking people, please do not listen to what the priests of the church are saying, listen to what the Bible is saying. and the Bible contains the truth. So please let us listen to the Bible and not to the people. This movement was called Reformation. What does Reformation mean? Reformation means trying to reform something, trying to change something for the good. So this was what was Reformation. Reformation was that movement which started in Europe because of the corrupt practices of the church, and which was led by a few individuals. Most importantly, we had Martin Luther King. He was a German, and these people asked people not to listen to the clergymen or to the officials of the church because they had become corrupt, and instead go back to the Bible, listen or read the Bible, understand the Bible, and follow its ways. So this was all about Reformation. There were a few other people also who led Reformation in different areas. There was John Calvin, there was Robert Zwingli, I guess. Reformation had many different. We had the one which Martin Luther King had propounded. It was called Protestant Reformation, because it is also called Protestant because it was protesting against the ill practices of the church. That is why Protestant means people who are protesting. So Protestant Reformation was there. There was the Zwinglianism, there was the Calvinism. So there were many such Reformation movements which took place in different parts of Europe. Now, if suppose there was Reformation, then there had to be Counter-Reformation. What is Counter-Reformation? Counter-Reformation is when the church, when the Pope, they understood, when the officials or a few officials understood that as people are moving away from the church and going towards the Reformation or going or joining the Protestant movement, they are moving away from the Catholic church, joining the Protestant movement, people understood one thing. How about changing, or how about bringing changes in the church itself? Now, how about bringing changes in the church itself? Saying it may be easy, but then it was a hard task for many people who were actually trying to do that. And one of the most important person who was doing that was Saint Ignatius of Loyola. The Counter-Reformation was a movement which was aimed at keeping people intact with the Catholic Church, or not allowing bringing changes into the church itself, into the practices of the church, removing the corrupt practices, and not forcing people to do things which they are not asking people to reason. So those starting those practices in order to keep people within the Catholic Church movement or within the Catholic Church, and not allowing them to, or not forcing them to move outside. So when the Reformation movement or the Counter-Reformation happened in the church itself, what happened? People did not move away from this Catholic Church and join the Protestant movement. So the Counter-Reformation was also a movement which was started by the officials of the Catholic Church in order to change the corrupt practices, or in order to remove the corruption which had entered into the church or into the church officials, and in doing so they actually succeeded in keeping the Catholic Church alive, and they also succeeded in putting a stop, or not a full stop maybe, but putting a pause to the movement of people from the Catholic Church to the Protestant Church and the Protestant movements. So this was about Reformation and Counter-Reformation. Now let us talk of the next part. So next we have the Voyages of Discovery. Or let me just tell you one thing. When we talk of rationalism, when we talk of Renaissance, we are talking of people starting to think. Okay, that was not a pause, that was a deliberate pause actually. What did I just say? It allowed people to think. When I am saying allowed people to think, suppose you are asked not to think, and you have not thought for 10 years. Okay, it may be the case for many of you, just joking. But then if you all have not thought for 10 years, and suddenly if you are allowed to think today, or I say, okay, you are free to think, what happens? You get ideas, you start reasoning, you start thinking. And when you get ideas, when you, okay, some ideas may be absurd, some ideas may be world-changing ideas. That was what was happening in Europe. People had not thought for so many centuries. The church had put a stop. But when they were allowed to think, they started coming up with ideas. Different kinds of ideas, different kinds of questions. And when they started questioning, when you all start questioning, what happens? Ideas crop up and newer things start happening. Newer things are discovered. Newer things are known of. Newer things are thought of. That was what was happening in Europe. When people started thinking, people started understanding, people started reasoning, people started inventing. And when these inventions started happening, changes came in the world. And when it is because of those inventions, those changes, that we are having a world which we are having right now. Now, as I was telling, or as I may have told in one of the previous lectures, there was trade happening between the Europeans and the Asians. And this trade, mainly the partners of trade or trade, happened from the Indian kingdoms, from the Chinese kingdoms, and from a few other kingdoms in the Middle East. The Persians were there, the other ones were there, there were other such kingdoms in the Middle East. Trade happened between these Asian kingdoms with the European kingdoms and the European nations. This trade in the medieval times and the earlier times used to happen via the overland route. It was because people believed that the earth was flat. Now, what is the overland route? Let me just route over to the map and show you all. Okay, so as I was discussing, over here we have the map of the world, or half of it, as you can see. And this half of the map, as I was telling, we had the ancient trade route was the overland route, because at that time people used to believe, before rationalism came into Europe, people used to believe that the earth was flat. And because the earth was flat, as you all know, that if something is as people believed that the earth was flat, the people could fall off. From the edges of the world. That is why people did not dare to travel far into the sea. That is why the main trading route was the land route. Now, there was an ancient trade route called the Silk Route. If you all have heard of the Silk Route started from China. It moved from China. It passed through these countries. Then it went to this country, as you can see over here. Let me just... you have Turkey over there. So, from China it moved to Turkey, and after Turkey it moved to boats and other vessels were used. The trade used to, or the merchandise or the items of trade, those used to land at Turkey, cross through this Mediterranean Sea over here, and after that moved to Italy. As I was telling, Italy was the staging point, or Italy was the central point of trade in Europe. Here we have Italy, and from Italy, it isn't getting focused. Here we have Italy over here, and from Italy, the trade used to move to other parts of Europe. We have Poland, Berlin, Germany. We have United Kingdom, London. So this Italy over here, Italy was the main staging point. And from Italy, the trade used to move Mediterranean Sea. So this was the trade route which was used by most of the traders. And trade from India joined the Silk Route over here. Trade from other parts of Asia also joined the Silk Route. And all that trade from China, from India, from the Middle Eastern countries, from the other countries over here, from the other kingdoms over here. We did not have countries then. Back then in the medieval times, we had kingdoms. So all these kingdoms, all the trade from these kingdoms used to move through this land route, go to Turkey, then via a little bit of, there was this sea route in the Mediterranean Sea. After that it went to Italy and then to other parts of Europe. And also the reverse trade also happened the same way. From Europe it used to come to Italy, and from Italy, after the Mediterranean Sea, it used to reach Turkey and then travel to other parts of Asia. Now this Turkey over here, as you can see, Turkey was Turkey was the Asian bridge, and the and Italy was the European or the European part of the bridge. So this Turkey was important. And after the fall of Constantinople, it was Turkey used to be ruled by the Christian rulers. And after the fall of Constantinople, after the Muslim rulers or after the invaders took hold of Turkey, Constantinople, the city over there, modern day in Istanbul. So after Turkey was captured by, or after Turkey fell, what happened was this part of Turkey was taxed heavily, or the trade passing through Turkey was taxed heavily, and people were not allowed to trade that freely. That is why it became very important for the European traders to find a newer route. And this newer route was given fuel by Magellan. So, all thanks to Magellan then, because it was Magellan who told us, or told the world, that okay, it is safe to move outside. See, I have done it. I made a circumnavigated the earth. He made a full round of the earth and he came back well and alive, smiling. So he told the people, or he told the Europeans, see, you all can also move further. And because the overland route was blocked by the Ottoman Empire, the Ottoman Turks, because Turkey was under the rule of the Ottomans. The Ottomans had taken away Constantinople from the Christian emperors. So Ottoman Turks had put a blockage, and they had blocked the trade route happening, the overland route. So because of this, the people of Europe started, and as I told you, there was already reasoning and rationalism had entered into the Europeans. So they started thinking, okay, let us then move out with our ships. So everyone, people started moving around with their ships. They started rowing, they started sailing, the captains. I'm the captain, Vasco da Gama. I moved out with my ship. I moved off from Europe. I traveled through Africa. Through the borders of Africa, through the coastline of Africa, by the Cape of Good Hope, that is Cape Town in South Africa. And then I reached Calicut in India. That was the sea route which was discovered to India. All thanks to Vasco da Gama. Hadn't Vasco da Gama come to India, the Portuguese wouldn't have come, the Dutch wouldn't have come, the French wouldn't have come, the English wouldn't have come, and we would have still been under the rule of the Mughal Empire. It may not be that scenario for all of us, but then it would have been so, or not the Mughal Empire, but we would have been small kingdoms, small countries still today. Now they came. The Europeans came to India, and not only India, they started moving around to different parts of the world. Christopher Columbus moved away with his three ships, Nina, Pinta and Santa Maria. I am not making these names up. These are the names of the ships, Nina, Pinta and Santa Maria. So Nina, Pinta, Santa Maria, and okay, so Christopher Columbus was not standing on three ships at a time. He did not have three legs. He was not dividing himself. He was leading on one ship and the other two ships were coming behind him. So he went out to search for India, and instead of India, he found the West Indies, and also he discovered the continents of America. And after the discovery of the continents of America, after finding the sea route to India, the Europeans, they started moving out, and they started capturing new areas, new lands. So this age of discovery is very important, these voyages of discovery. And these voyages of discovery were also aided by, these voyages of discovery. Now, I give you a ship and I ask you to, okay, you are free to go into the sea, and in the sea you have to reach, you have to reach Australia. You do not have a compass, you do not know anything about the movement of the stars or the position of the stars, and you do not have other instruments which are required, you do not have a chart. What do you do? Do you reach Australia? Maybe if you are very, very lucky, you will be reaching Australia. Else, you'll be moving in circles, or maybe you'll be reaching Andaman and Nicobar Islands and thinking, yay, I've reached Australia. So there were a few inventions which actually made it easier for people to teach different parts of the world. Those inventions were, okay, I'm having two different things. Okay, I can say there was the magnetic compass, there was the astrolabe, and there was also the quadrant. So these mariners, these, and also the adjustable sails, these help people to find newer routes, to chart newer routes so as to find different countries. Well, I am going to a new place. I am suppose you go to a new place and you do not know anything about that place, you do not know anything about the people, people do not know about you. Those people are living in closed quarters, those people are living in their own world. You go there suddenly, what happens? If you go there with the intention of trading, people will be happy, maybe. People may attack you, most probably. So you may be attacked. And what should you do so as to prevent that attack? You will be carrying with you people so as to prevent any such attack. And along with the people, you will be carrying with you arms. So the invention of gunpowder. Gunpowder was invented in China. And the Chinese, from China, the idea of the gunpowder moved to the different places, different countries, and then the Europeans used the gunpowder to their very good, or put the gunpowder to a very good use. They brought guns, gunpowder, and people so as to so that when they moved to a different, or when they discovered a different country, different land, different island, they could use those people, the gunpowder and the guns, so as to intimidate the people, or so as to capture newer lands, newer territories. So these inventions helped the Europeans capture new lands, get hold of new lands, access new land, and this made the Europeans prosper. When you capture a new land, you also get the resources of that land. So as Europe, the Europeans started capturing or getting new lands, they started becoming prosperous, and this was one of the reasons why the Renaissance also started moving to different other countries other than Italy. So the Renaissance started spreading to most other parts of Europe. There was prosperity everywhere. The Europeans were rich and happy. And the next part then, what happens? They now needed, as there was prosperity, there were more people. Or people started demanding better goods, more food to eat, better food to eat, better clothes to wear. That is what led to the Industrial Revolution. When we talk of the Industrial Revolution, the first thing that comes to our mind is industries, industries, industries. So this industries, industries, industries will be done in the next video, or I'll be telling you all about it in the next video. And after that, we'll be wrapping up this chapter. Till then, please stay happy, be productive, and do not allow this or use this lockdown productively so that there is no regret left after the lockdown is over. Thank you, and take care.